A very good evening to all the participants who are attending this side event. On behalf of the World Bank, MNRE, SBI, Suprabha TA program, and we have seen an overwhelming response of over 630 registrations from almost six countries across the world, so different time zones. So I should start with good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all the participants who are even now logging in. We have already had 200 registrations plus who have joined in out of the 600, and we believe people will continue to join. It's a wonderful evening, and I believe most of you would have attended the ADB's Asia Clean Energy Forum many times in the past 6-7 years, if not more. I would say it's 11th year if I'm right. And at least in the panel, I have Amit, who we both have attended more than three or two, I would say, these sessions. And it happens in the evening. Evening is a lot of fun at ADB's premises, and a lot of side events happening, a lot of buzzing around, 1500 people plus at any point of time to network. But now it's a different world today and a different situation, and we all appreciate. For the first time, we are all facing the same situation across the world. That itself is unique. But having said that, that has given a glimpse of what you can kind of gain in this situation, in the absence of the pollution, in the absence of transport, in the absence of so many industrial activities. Of course, the economic question is always there in front of us. But I don't know whether to say thanks to pandemic, we are witnessing what a clean and a green world will look like for our grandchildren at least. And this would be a temporary phenomenon, we know that. But when we want to go back, there's a lot of opportunity to think about how do we want to go back. And that is how we thought this subject would definitely be making a lot of sense. I'm extremely thankful to ADB ACF organizers who were kind enough to allow us to have this side event. And this journey, when we presented this to JS, Mr. Amitesh Sinhaji, he said, what do you think we have achieved that we should have this event? That was so kind of a modest question, but he was also poking me, you know. So then I said, sir, it is like when the program started, we were at kind of 1.2 or 1.4 gigawatt, and now we are 5.4. So at least personally, I'm happy that we have been a part of this journey. And the people who have joined us, the stakeholders, the heroes, and everybody who has put in a lot of efforts have to be recognized. So we would like to show this as a success journey, and also learnings pulls out. And that's a very good kind of a title which my colleague Abhinav had coined for this side event. So that's a kind of a very quick prelude in terms of what we have today. We have the stellars from the industry, from the government, and from the donor agency, from the DISCOM. So we have from the financing industry. So we have a lot of action to witness as we start this event. We are waiting for also MNRE Joint Secretary to join us, but we will go ahead with this event. So the idea of this event is to basically share. The objective is to share whatever we have achieved so far and whatever we have even failed so far in certain aspects of the solar rooftop journey. It is not always a success that we would like to share. We also want to share the learnings and how to improve upon the failures, and also kind of innovate new ideas and learn from everyone. And we always have references to US or Germany or any other developed country. So why not we for a change take the developing countries as an example and try to share the South-South knowledge. So that was one of the major objectives of this session. I know that we won't have answers to all your questions, but it's just a humble start. This program has been kind of 2.5 years old, the Suprabha Technical Assistance Program. So we are so happy to be a part of this event and share all the experience that we have gained so far. And fortunately, all the panelists here are directly associated with this Technical Assistance Program so far. I would like to welcome each one of you for this for joining us in this panel discussion and for the presentation. It's going to be a wonderful network, and we'll continue to work towards a better sustainable Indian rooftop solar journey. So with those few words, please allow me to give a quick glimpse of what we have done under this Technical Assistance Program and what are the issues in general when we started and what are the achievements so far. We have a long way to go, but I'll try to summarize as much as possible within the short period of time. So Siddhant, could you please show the presentation, please? Siddhant? today. I hope my screen is visible. Yeah. So Amit, can you see my screen?
Yes, please. Go ahead, Dinesh.
Yeah, sorry. So this is the program which I mentioned to you, the Sustainable Partnership for Rooftop Solar Acceleration in Bharat. So it's a program which falls under the World Bank Group, State Bank of India, and MNRE. And this program started way back in August 2017. It covers 17 states and meant to kind of assist all the stakeholders in terms of consumers, the DISCOMs, the urban local bodies, the commercial and industrial consumers, financing institutions and entrepreneurs. It is basically prelude to the $625 million long-term concessional loan extended by the World Bank to SBI. Amit will say more about this. I don't want to steal his thunder. This program started, as I told you, 2.5 years ago, and we have done a lot of activities across the six interventions. I would give a quick background of how we arrived at these six interventions in my next slide. So they cover policy regulatory, capacity building, media outreach, process streamlining, south-south knowledge exchange, and then demand aggregation. So this is a kind of a complicated slide. It's just to show you how complicated the sector was when we started the program. And even before that, I would say Anurag will agree and Abhishek will agree as well. In terms of how the stakeholders were so much interconnected, largely to deliver the intended results. But having said that, there were limited stakeholders, but unlimited challenges. So we try to map in terms of how they are interconnected, and we found that each and every challenge is very nicely and directly linked to each and every other stakeholder. So it is not that one stakeholder is in isolation, but there's a lot of interconnection, a lot of challenges. Even today, we have many of these challenges which we are trying to overcome. But this was a kind of a situation, as I told you when I started the presentation, close to 1.2, 1.4 gigawatt at that point of time when we had the kind of initial situation as such. So then under the technical assistance program, which the Ernst & Young consortium managed to win under the international competitive bidding, we became the PMC, the project managing consultant, and working very closely with the World Bank, MNRE, and SBI, a central PMC was established to effectively deliver the TA program in 17 states. So we initially started doing the readiness assessment and then start coordinating with the state teams. We also had state coordinators being posted and positioned in key states, actually, based on the prioritization. MP, Madhya Pradesh is one of the prioritized states. We have Mr. Manu Srivastava in this session as well. And then we created state-specific action plans, and we found how the synergies could be established in terms of the challenges identified, how to develop the solutions, etc. And the best and the most important part was how to engage with the different stakeholders in the state. So this was a kind of a key to success in terms of how we positioned ourselves by having a centralized project management consultancy and then try to work with all the 17 states. So moving after that, it was to have a state prioritization framework where we try to identify the common themes on the right, which you could see in terms of the awareness, the policy, and in terms of the financing readiness of the institutions in the state, and how SBA can also make a difference in the state. And the most important part of how the process streamlining in terms of the digitization could work. So from that angle also, the framework was established to engage with all the states so that the kind of activities that are planned could be implemented in a better manner. So after 2.5 years, as I told you before, I'm extremely happy and proud to present the kind of achievements. We have a long way to go, but still the kind of achievements with the help of all the stakeholders and the stakeholders with whom I'm daily interacting, basically World Bank and MNRE and SBI. They supported a lot to achieve this aspect. And I would especially thank Madhya Pradesh also, because it showed a lot of kind of innovation in doing a lot of activities, which then triggered and other states started following it up. So we did a lot of activities in kind of all these six interventions. I'm not going to touch in each and every part. I'll show very quickly individually how they have made a difference to us. But the numbers are quite good in terms of how we see all these actions have happened with all the support of the consortium members and the state stakeholders. But more important, what we have to now witness is the actual megawatt on ground. And that would make a lot of difference when we start reporting how many megawatts have been installed out of these interventions we have had. So very quickly, in terms of the policies and regulations, we have done a lot of work in the Northeast to develop the policy and the vendor empanelment manual. In terms of the national level, the major breakthrough came when we published the model rooftop solar regulations, which were updated way back. It was in 2013. And then we updated the model rooftop solar regulation in 2019. That is available in the public domain under the CERC website. And you can download that to find more about what are the new recommendations we have given. In terms of the demand aggregation, as it says, we were quite successful in aggregating the demand, again, thanks to Madhya Pradesh, which demonstrated how digitally we could establish a data room and give access to the developers, who can then make their decision as much informed as possible, along with other parameters related to the subsidy and the other locational aspects and other technical aspects. But I would say the data room made a huge difference in terms of getting the lowest kind of tariff for the public sector as well as the state government sector. Of course, it had a tag of 45% subsidy as well. So we stand very, very nicely in terms of how much work we have done so far. 4,000 sites, 340 megawatt, and almost 50%, more than 50% of it has been tendered already. And we are moving towards how it is being financed and how it is being deployed on ground. In terms of the web portal, which is the digital aspects of it, we are very closely working with 12 states across the country and trying to develop and launch the unified web portals. We have seen a lot of progress very recently, largely because of the residential program by MNRE, which is going to be linked only through the unified web portal. So a lot of progress in terms of how the states are trying to implement all this interconnection through the digital aspects of it. Media has been a very key aspect. Again, Madhya Pradesh, we were able to do a lot of work in the state, which we again start propagating in other states as well and motivate them to do a lot of work in the outreach area. So we did 8 films on the rooftop solar case studies in Madhya Pradesh and 1 television commercial as well. And we launched a couple of websites for the ministry, and a lot of media collaterals were developed and launched during this 2.5 years by a consortium partner, Edelman. Moving forward, in terms of the key aspect of the capacity building, we were able to train more than 1,500 stakeholders, largely from the utility and the SBI fraternity. SBI officials from all over the country came together, and then we managed to train all of them so far in a very, I would say, in a conducive manner, largely because SBI had their own training institutes where they conducted these trainings. And it was very nice to see all the SBI officers across the country coming for this training program, which are 2-day training programs. And for the DISCOM officials also, we were so happy to cover all the 17 states. And we have conducted training programs to the DISCOM officials as well. So having said that, we are on the cusp of moving towards the direct engagement with the DISCOMs, which were not that initially heavy or intense with them, because we are working with the state nodal agencies. But now, under the new MNRE phase 2 program, the kind of focus is to engage with the DISCOMs and then try to help them as much as we can so that they can implement the residential rooftop solar program. So therefore, we are focusing to create all this enabling environment through the digital interventions as much as possible. And that leads to, in terms of how what kind of a foresight the program had and how World Bank and MNRE and SBI were supporting throughout in terms of developing all these capabilities in developing digital interventions. Either it could be unified web portal or it could be a data room, as I mentioned to you. This was wholly owned. The idea was wholly owned by Manusar and AB by Amit in the early times of 2017. And we are able to now establish a very huge kind of a success in terms of utilization of the data room. And very recently, we have launched the vendor management portal work, again in Madhya Pradesh. The regulation also, we kind of gave recommendations for a lot of advanced metering infrastructure related digital kind of a work. And also we established a framework for a national level data monitoring for the rooftop solar projects as well. So from that angle, we could even establish the state level monitoring centers if a state needs to establish such kind of a monitoring scheme. So moving on this, given the current situation we have in the COVID times, we are also trying to venture upon whether we could do a optimization of digitization in the value chain on the rooftop solar. It's in the conceptual stage. We are trying to see how we can help the DISCOMs, vendors, the consumers, and the financial institutions as much as possible to work on the online, given the current situation that it would extend up to the next 6 months or even a year, where the business as usual cannot be achieved 100%. So from that angle, this venture would demand a lot of data, but at the same time, it demands a lot of trust. So we are trying to work as much as we could on this front as well. One last thing before I conclude is that we have also recently finalized a white paper. It will be soon available on our website. This white paper is basically a collection and a culmination of a lot of thought process and suggestions from the World Bank and from SBI and from the developers and from the DISCOM. So as much as we could engage with the stakeholders, we collected all their inputs. Then we bucketed them in very focused areas in terms of the first one is financing, where we have given specific recommendations on private sector lending, which RBI can help us, and then also try to give some recommendations on the debt financing aspect of it, to simplify it or to have the letter of credit by the off-taker in terms of mitigating the payment for risk of projects, and also promote the partial risk guarantee fund for supporting the MSMEs who have been badly hit to the current situation as well. So these are a few areas that we have recommended on the financing side. And on the liquidity issued in tenders also, we have recommended in terms of certain best practices, which we also largely found in the MP RESCO tender. Again, thanks to Manu sir, who revolutionized the whole tendering process for better response. On the institutional regulatory side, we have highlighted how the DISCOMs can become active participants. Therefore, how they can facilitate and also invest in business models, and then try to help them in digitization, as I explained to you before, and then help them also to understand how to have some deployment targets, because without any plan, they'll not be able to really take the vision forward as such. And we have some recommendations on open access as well to reduce the criteria from 1 megawatt to 500, reduce the grid access charges, and also allow the simultaneous open access and net metering aspect. So these are the few recommendations we feel that we could submit to MNRE, and therefore MNRE could then accordingly take a kind of some action or suggestions to implement such recommendations. More important on the quality side, in terms of emphasizing the need for more certified lab, and also have an integrated kind of international standards for design and installation for the rooftop solar plants. So these are the recommendations. We will intimate each one of you once this paper is available on our website. You can provide your comments and then find and submit it to the respective stakeholders. So sorry that I have taken much of your time, but I thought it's worthwhile to explain to you the kind of journey we had for the past 2.5 years, and we have another 1.5 years to go. And we feel that we have come to some extent to be proud enough to say that we have at least initiated this moment. We are very sure that the entire stakeholders in the whole process would be energized and motivated to take this forward. So thank you so much for your patient listening. Now, without much shadow, I would like to invite Amit Jain to give his presentation. I believe Amitesh G is yet to join. I'll just check. Amit, give me 5 seconds. Yeah, so he's yet to join, Amit. So in the before I invite you, Amit, sorry for the interruption. So we have the first poll. This is now open for the participants, so organizers and panelists cannot vote. So I request the participants to very quickly select your options. Which crucial bidding parameters fosters a healthy, competitive and aggressive bidding? You can select this. In the meanwhile, panelists, we can also kind of influence the voters. So, Amit, what do you feel? Which is a crucial bidding parameter?
I would like the audience decide.
we can rig it, don't worry, we can rig the polls.
Please go ahead, Dinesh.
Yeah, okay, so the parameters, as you could see, is onboarding and payment by consumers, subsidy and incentives, minimum bid processing fees, if not, no bid for processing fee, the performance guarantee, which should be attractive, ceiling tariff, the reverse bidding. So these are the parameters you can choose. So I'm going to now close this. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So you can close it, and we will announce the results very soon. So Amit Jain, now I request you to give your views. Amit Jain is from the World Bank, the senior energy specialist, and he has worked a lot with me. We have worked a lot, and we have traveled also, as I told you, to Manila. So let's give that ambience, Amit, that as if we are in Manila, and then we can go ahead with your presentation. So over to you.
Thanks, Dinesh. First of all, you can never create Manila sitting here in Delhi. But can you see my screen?
Yes.
You can, right? Okay. So while you see this video, let me first tell you, forget whatever everything what Dinesh has said, because he has told us the end of the journey of solar rooftop in India. He didn't tell us how did we reach here. And secondly, right now the video which you are seeing is on a lake in Bhopal in Madhya Pradesh, where solar rooftop is being installed by boats, as you can see. This is where we stand in India in terms of innovations on solar rooftop, or in terms of floating solar, that we have solar panels being installed on the embankments of a lake in Bhopal. I'm not sure if you can also see sunlight on my face. This is 6 p.m. in Delhi in India, and we can still see broad and sunny sunlight in India, because we have 300 days, not only in India, but also in South Asia. So the plan of this solar rooftop program is to utilize these 300 days and create innovative projects. As again, you can see on your screen, is a beautiful project in Bhopal, where solar rooftop is being installed on educational institutions, on police stations, on schools, and on a lake, which you see right now. So this is a time gap video we have done on a lake in Madhya Pradesh, where you see in a very extreme situation on a lake, solar rooftop being installed. Now, as I was saying, this is the end of the journey. This is not how we started. The situation of solar rooftop has taken a lot of steps before we have reached here. There are two ways, I must tell you, we are going to answer the questions here to the audience who are hooked in. First, as Dinesh mentioned, we have a chat box where you can ask your questions, and we're going to try to answer most of your questions. In case you're not able to find that your question is being answered, then you can write to me on my Twitter as well, where I can try to answer your question. So these are a couple of ways in which we are going to try to answer your question. Now, let's first see how solar rooftop was 5 years back. What we are talking about is that right now India is at 5 to 6 gigawatts of solar rooftop against a target of 40 gigawatts. But this was not the case 5 years back when solar rooftop program is being installed. Also, for the audience, I would like to mention that India is known as a leader in solar globally, but we are a leader in solar parks or in utility scale solar, where you have projects like 100 gigawatt or more than 100 megawatts, sorry. But in case of solar rooftop, we are still struggling to some extent. For example, if you can see, against a 100 gigawatt target, we have currently 35 gigawatts of solar installed, out of which 30 is for solar parks or for utility scale solar. Solar rooftop is only at 5 to 6 gigawatt against a target of 40 gigawatts. So we are still in the process of making solar rooftop successful. And again, as I mentioned, I'm sitting in Delhi. I pay 7 rupees as tariff to BSES, but if I install solar rooftop, I get 4 rupees. Still, I have to think twice before installing solar rooftop. So there are ground challenges in installing a power project right now on my roof. This is not only limited to financing. this goes much beyond financing. Here we are talking about awareness. Is the common man in India aware of solar benefits of solar rooftop? Is the current regulatory and policy are conducive for solar rooftop? We will see more about it in the later slides. And then bankers are also not very keen to give financing to solar rooftop. Just imagine there is a 100 megawatt plant or a 100 kilowatt plant. The transaction cost and time for a banker is almost the same. So they would prefer a larger plant when they go for lending. Now, Germany and California has been the leaders in solar rooftop. Most of the revolution in these countries and these states have been driven by residential sector solar rooftop, which is not the case in India. So I wanted to give you also a ground check on what Dinesh mentioned beforehand, that there are still structural challenges in this journey of solar rooftop in India, which we are currently trying to resolve. Some of them has been briefly touched on policy and regulatory challenges. DISCOMs are still not very keen to have solar rooftop because they see as a threat for their cash cows, like commercial and industrial users, which are the major users for major revenue sources for DISCOMs. So they are not very keen to have net metering regulations and have solar rooftops in their portfolio. SNAs, the state solar agencies, their capacity is limited and they want to take their own time in tendering and completing the procedures. Although we have some cases in Delhi, in Bihar now, in Madhya Pradesh, which has taken leadership role in India on solar rooftop, but this is yet to be seen across several states in India. We will go through these, some of these challenges on solar rooftop also in details. As of now, if we divide the solar rooftop into three major segments of commercial and industrial, second is the government sector, and the third is residential sector. Most of the portfolio or the projects have come from commercial and industrial sector, because this is a sector where roofs are very high. They can give us more than 100 kilowatt per roof. And also these are the customers which are paying higher tariffs. So in the SBI program, we have seen a lot of pipeline and portfolio has come from commercial and industrial. We have an ongoing program with SBI where $648 million of loan has been signed. A target of 400 megawatt was being set, against which 225 megawatt has already been installed and operating. So the project has been quite successful so far. We are 3 years down the line in this project. The reason we chose SBI, or Government of India asked us to work with SBI, because SBI has more than 22,000 branches in India. Some people go to the extent of saying that 20% of India's GDP comes from State Bank of India. So they are basically driving the nation. So we were very lucky and thankful that we were partnered with SBI, and they have utilized their network on the ground to drive this success story. Now, again, let's take a step back. When the National Solar Mission was launched in India in 2010, in the first 6 years, only 500 megawatts of solar rooftop was being installed, mobilizing only $500 million. This is when the Government of India and MNRE asked the World Bank to partner with SBI on this $648 million loan. At that point of time, I must confess, SBI was the first risk taker in the market. There were no other loans available in the market. The only loan which was available was from non-banking financial corporations at the rate of 16% to 17% for 7 years. So this killed the business model for solar rooftop, because if the cost of capital is at 17%, this makes solar rooftop unviable. At this point of time, we partnered with SBI and we launched this $648 million product. The interest rates were brought down to 9%. You saw that from 17% to 9%, the markup of 8% was reduced in single shot, because we were able to mobilize clean technology fund and other grant sources for this line of credit. After World Bank and SBI signed this loan, in the next 2-3 years, we saw other multilaterals, other commercial banks like Punjab and National Bank, Bank of Baroda, ICICI Bank, they launched their own line of credit for solar rooftop once they start seeing that SBI has been doing a lot of deals in this area. So this project opened up, mainstreamed the commercial financing for solar rooftop. 5 years down the line, 3 years down the line from 2016, in the last 3 years, India has jumped from 500 megawatts to almost 5.5 gigawatts today as we speak, and the project has mobilized more than $4 billion of financing with the help of other multilaterals and commercial banks in India. But our goal remains bigger. We are working with MNRE to achieve the solar rooftop goals going forward in the next few years as well. This slide has already been covered by Dinesh, but I must tell you here, and I cannot emphasize more, solar rooftop is not beyond is not only about financing. It is about strengthening the ecosystem of policy and regulatory, capacity building, demand aggregation, and media and outreach. It is very important to work closely with DISCOMs and SNAs on the ground. Right now, as we speak, the team of Superba is working in 17 states. We have offices grounded in 17 states where they're working very closely on the ground with these bodies. So if we want solar rooftop to be successful, we have to work very closely with the state governments, because electricity is a concurrent subject in India, where state governments take the final calls for net metering regulations and other regulations for solar rooftop. So while solar parks are being driven by SECI or NTPC or even with state governments, but solar rooftop can only become successful if the state governments come forward. Again, as Dinesh mentioned, several media campaigns have been launched in several state governments and in at the central level as well. So if you have any questions, please write in the chat box. We will try to answer them. Otherwise, during panel discussion, we can also take some of your questions. Dinesh, over to you.
Thank you, Amit. So we have the results. And of course, the outcome is well known. In terms of the payment assurance, I think that is what the audience have chosen. And surprisingly, most of it has got equal weightage in terms of subsidy, ceiling, tariff, and reverse bidding. Okay, thank you, guys. We can remove this poll results now. And again, thank you, Amit, once again, for a very clear layout in terms of the journey which we had traveled. And of course, I cherish each and every part of that journey which we have traveled so far in this. And then we know that a lot to be done. Without much ado, now let me invite Mr. KP Baiju. I believe he managed to join. Siddhant, did he manage to join?
Yeah, I'm there.
It's a very good evening to you, sir.
Good evening, good evening. Am I audible? Or yes, I don't think I'm visible. I am audible, I believe.
No, sir, you are visible. Absolutely fine.
Okay. Great.
So, KP Baiju is the DGM from SBI. So he's the man you should look for. And he has gained a lot of experience in terms of funding the solar projects. And he's continuing this journey, and he's quite passionate about what he's doing. So thank you once again, Mr. Baiju, for joining us. Then if the floor is yours, you can present the slides are being controlled by my team, if I'm right. So you can go ahead.
Sure. Thank you, Dinesh. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak at such an august audience across the world. So it is a great opportunity for me. I think most of the areas have been covered by you and Amit, and you have said about the partnership with SBI, World Bank, and all those, and the details have been covered. So as a lender, I would like to focus on the role of the lender in this. Like you said, in the beginning, when we started this journey way back in 2016, when the agreement was signed, but things were not looking great. In fact, the government also was also just waking up to the possibilities of using renewable energy, especially solar, as an option. So government had formulated good policy initiatives, started formulating good policy initiatives at that time. And we as the lead number one bank in the country also felt that this is the opportune moment to get in. And that is how the partnership with World Bank happened. is a substantial line of credit. 625 million is a substantial amount for an nascent industry. An industry was just about trying to find its feet. So early days, there were quite a number of challenges in this. It was basically what we felt that from our interactions with our operating staff, there was an amount of skepticism. Right from the beginning, the biggest skepticism is because as a lender, the type of loans which we give are basically term loans and they are of longer duration. As bankers, any longer duration project has an amount of doubt in it, whether the project will last, whether the technology will last, whether it will stay the distance, because your repayment continues, say, after 10 years, 15 years. So these were the initial skepticism in this area, because what happens is most of the in the rooftop area, most of the things came from outside. In fact, the panels were mostly from China or Malaysia and all. So the quality of the panels was one of the concerns, especially in the initial stages. And at that time, we understand that the cost differential was also not much, because the panels, the cost of panels in 2016 was much more. I think it should have come down by another 30 to 40% or more than that presently. So those were initial days, but to the credit of our team at the branches, they took up the challenge very well. And although the first year was not really good, but going forward, I think 2017-18 was a game changer. There was really good growth on the ground, the awareness level among the operating staff. This is one of the issues which we face. People are not aware about how to go about, because handling a solar lending is a different proposition. It's not a typical project lending. So getting into those areas, for that, again, thanks to the partnership with ENY and World Bank, we could organize trainings and all. So that has kindled a great amount of curiosity among our people also, and that has occurred. So that has helped us in at least creating pockets of excellence. Some of the branches have done exceedingly well, and to promote that further, in fact, we launched campaigns also, campaign programs to create more, to give a more clear push to these projects. And that those actions, coordinated actions along with trainings plus campaigns, have slowly started yielding results. In fact, we have I should be proud to say that as a bank, we have done really well. As against around 625 million, we have covered almost 66% of the distance, close to 420 million we have done, and another 50 million is in the pipeline. So we are well on track on achieving that. But again, like I said, country-wise, if rooftop, we have, as a country, probably we have done a 5 to 6 gigawatt. There is much more potential. There is tremendous potential, but acceptability has to come in. I believe that going forward, rooftop solar is going to be a game changer, provided the battery storage issue is also resolved, in the sense that the prices have to come down. One of the biggest detriment for any solar project, not only rooftop solar, the people here look at it that, see, I invest that, but I can't rely on it for 24 hours. It gives me power only for a limited period of time. Without storage, it doesn't serve my purpose fully. I have to go back to the distribution company, which gives me power, the electricity bodies, which give me power for my remaining. So once as a banker, we feel when the storage thing, if the prices come down, the storage facilities improve and the prices come down to more reasonable level, I believe that will really change the face of rooftop solar. With the kind of potential we have, as a country, also even in the tier 2, tier 3 cities, there are enough roofs available. So the kind of roofs we have going forward, those can be used very well. Although as an organization, we started mainly for commercial and industrial. I believe that even in the industrial segment, we have barely scratched the surface. industrial also has tremendous potential because they typically fall under the high tariff area, and they can save a lot. I think post COVID also there could be some change in that because people would the companies would look at areas in where cost could be managed. One of the areas would be growth. If you see the economy, the global economy is not growing at a fast pace, and even pre-COVID also Indian growth rates were also subdued. So going forward, we don't expect the economy to bounce back at that rate. Then cutting costs would be a very, very handy proposition, especially for the industrial units. As a lender, we have been trying to provide affordable line of credit thanks to World Bank, which has provided us, which we could on-lend all to the end users. The interest rates have come down really drastically. If you look at it, when we signed the agreement somewhere in 2016, from there, I think we have reduced the interest rates by almost 250 basis points. So, which is quite a substantial number. This adds to the savings. So the cost of installation has come down. The interest costs have come down. So I think going forward, rooftop solar is going to be attractive, not only for the industrial segment. Now we understand that the government also keen that rooftop is installed on government buildings also. So once the government also takes the lead in pushing for government buildings having rooftop, I think we also, as a banker, we have a very good lending opportunity, and industrial units, like I mentioned, is already in place, but there the potential all remains to be still to be tapped. So going ahead, it looks really good post COVID. I think once the economy is back on its feet, I think we should be doing a good job. The rooftop solar looks to be a very bright segment. Solar especially should be the with the country also pushing for renewable energy as a focus area, I think we will be doing good things. If you look at it as a bank also, we have focused more on SMEs. Most of our lendings have been to SMEs. You'll be surprised to know out of this 420 million, which I mentioned, that almost 70 to 75% of the amounts have gone to small units. So we have been helping the smaller units, which typically in India is defined as the micro, small and medium enterprises. So as a bank also, we have been focusing on such projects. Of course, the larger projects are also there, but the individual projects of customers who are already banking with us are getting funds from that. We are leaders in lending in rooftop in the country by a mile. By our nearest competitor is much, much far below. So we still believe, but we have not grown as expected. We'd like to achieve much more. We also have been given a target of around close to 600 megawatt, and we have done. We are on course to achieve the target. We have done close to more than 400 megawatt. So all in all, rooftop solar is slowly but steadily changing the face of India. The government is also very keen. Government now, they as part of their activities to double the agriculture income, they have launched a scheme whereby the agriculture farmers, they can use their unused land, uncultivated land, for installing solar panels, and which will be connected to the grid. So as a bank here also, we have taken the lead. We have designed products to meet the farmers' needs. That because typically, as you know, agriculture is a highly subsidized commodity, and we continue to subsidize them with cheap power or free power. So the installation of solar panels will not only augment their income, but will also save the government of supplying free power. All in all, the rooftop story appears to be really good, and going forward, as you see the numbers on the screen, so we have done really well, but we hope to do further well in the days ahead. So this is brief about what SBI's journey has been so far. If there are any questions, I am willing to take it. Otherwise, it's thanks from me. Thank you Dinesh for giving me an opportunity. Thank you.
So thank you so much, sir. That was really wonderful to see the summary of the entire journey that you have started lending the rooftop solar in India. And very happy to also know the kind of lessons learned is being also going to go forward in applying for the new lending products as well, especially the residential sector. It will be great if we can have a residential financing product from SBI very soon. Given it has allocated already 600 to 800 megawatt across the country for the residential sector, financing becomes extremely important for this segment. Thank you so much, sir, for your. Yeah, we will again kind of put you in the panel where the questions will be posed to you by Amit, by the audience. So till then, I request you to be available online, and then we will get back.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, thank you, Dinesh. Sure.
So, Amit, I have to just run this poll, and then I have an update that Amitesh ji is just getting out of a Japanese delegation meeting. So he said he will try to kind of connect by 6:15. Otherwise, 5 minutes later. It's already 6:20. So, but I think we can start the panel, and whenever he joins, I will try to interrupt you if you don't mind. And he can give his views if we don't have any problem in that.
Yes, so when Amitesh joined, probably we can have him in the panel and we can ask him to share his views from the MNRE perspective, and we can continue with the panel discussion.
Sure. So just 1 minute, Amit, to show this. Can you show the results of the previous poll? We had it already, right? So, okay. So this is the second poll. So what interventions are needed to increase the access to finance for residential consumers? So that's a topic which I just mentioned to you after Maju sir had presented. So in terms of how you can enable this access to finance, because folks are finding it extremely difficult to consider 1 kilowatt projects versus a 10 kilowatt or even a 50 kilowatt or 100 kilowatt RWA residential welfare association projects. So how could you develop a standard financial product given the kind of expanded opportunities for the residential sector to get the finance? So you have some time to choose your option. It is not very easy because when I say residential consumer, as I told you, it could be one residential consumer with his individual home, or it could be a residential welfare association or a community housing schemes or how you call it, I'm not sure. In terms of the overall implementation of the residential solar project on the common kind of roof in the residential sector. So we are closing this 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We are closing it. And now we also have the results immediately this time. So it's kind of a close kind of a race between standard financial products and competitive interest rates. Okay, the interest rate, very interestingly, in India, definitely now in the single digits, and we have been told that it will be at par with the home loans, if not lower than that. So from that angle, I think the interest rate and the long tenure will have its own merit. But having a standard financial product, I think that's really, really important in terms of making the whole loan process for kilowatt or 100 kilowatt residential loan. I think we should try to have a standard financial product for making the lives of the bank's office to appraise it easily. Great. Thank you, guys. We can close the screen.